Welcome back. Now we've looked at the outline of a typical project finance legal structure, let's zoom in on the project loan agreement now. This agreement is central to the financing structure. It brings together most of the creativity that has gone into the development of project finance. The project loan is called a facilities agreement, which may seem like a strange name in this context. A facility is normally the name we give for a place that is provided for a specific purpose. The name here signals that the project loan facility can only be used for a very specific purpose. The use of the borrowed funds is highly scripted. The funds you borrow need to be defined in other project documents. We call that utilizing or drawing down the loan. For example, the EPC agreement may define that the project company must pay a tranche of the EPC contract sum as soon as a certain milestone has been reached in the construction. For example, 15% of the price when the foundation has been finished. Then the facilities agreement will allow the SPV to draw exactly that amount by submitting the invoice from the EPC contractor and only for that specific purpose. In a project financing, you have different facilities, each destined for the funding of a very specific purpose. There may be an O&M facility, for example, and you can guess what that is for. Like any loan agreement, the facilities agreement will define the amount to be borrowed, the term, this is the date or the various dates that the loan needs to be repaid, and the interest rate. However, in addition to these standard loan clauses, the facilities agreement will contain a number of very specific clauses that fit into the project finance context that we have described. I'm not going to discuss them all, that would send you all off to sleep, but let's concentrate on the most important ones. First of all, the facilities agreement will make a direct reference to all the other agreements in the transaction Bible, to signal that all these agreements collectively form part of the deal that has been agreed. Importantly, the offtake agreements will be referenced there. This secures that the revenue rights that the project company, and it's therefore the most important security for the lender. The rights of the offtake agreement will be assigned to the lender. That means that they are signed over to him as a security in case the project company should default. There will be an elaborate set of preconditions that the project company needs to fulfill before it can draw down the loan. These are called conditions precedent, and their purpose is to make sure that everything has been put in place for the project success. An example, the issuance of the necessary permits is a very important condition precedent, or CP, because you don't want the project earnings to be held up due to a delay in the licensing. The agreement will define a minimum level of debt service cover ratio. Remember that this is the ratio that tracks that the free cash flows, the CADS, cash available for debt service, is more than the cash flow needed to service the project loans. If the DSCR should drop below the agreed level, for example, because of higher costs or lower revenues, then the loan becomes more risky for the lender, and then the facility agreement usually provides that the lender may step in to protect its rights, and also that the interest rate goes up to reflect the increased lending risk that he then has. Project revenues may be irregular. We may have no revenue for a few years because we need to construct the project assets, and then we may have growing revenues while the operations are still ramping up. And then the returns may start to develop more regularly, growing with an increased use of the asset or with inflation. And ideally, we want the loan service, that's the interest and the loan repayments, to keep track with the incoming cash flows. In project finance, it's normal to adjust the loan repayment to match the net cash flows. And we call this debt sculpting. For example, there may be a grace period during the construction phase. That's a period when there are no loan repayments yet due. But conversely, if the loan is considered relatively risky, the banks may require a so-called cash sweep, meaning that all the cash that comes in, that is generated in the project, will be immediately used to early repay the project loans down to an agreed safer level. A final specific feature I want to mention is the settlement of the cash flows. In project finance, the lender does not want to leave it to chance that the project company will do the right thing and that it uses the cash flow to repay the loans. Payments are, again, highly scripted. The project company will require to open bank accounts at the lenders, through which all the cash flows are required to run, both in and outflows. These are called project accounts. The bank controls the in and outflows and can monitor that everything is going according to plan. Requested payments from, for example, for settling an EPC or O&M invoice must be documented by the closing contracts before they can be released by the bank. There is also an agreed sequence that all the payments must follow. That's the so-called waterfall or cascade. With all the revenues that come in, first, all the operating expenses must be settled. This makes sense because all the parties want the project to continue. The revenues depend on that. Second, we create a reserve fund for future operational costs. This ensures that the operations can continue even if revenues are at some stage interrupted. Then, the interest and loan repayments on the project loans are settled. Remember that the lenders have priority rights on the cash flows over the equity investors. And then lastly, whatever funds are left after all these steps may be distributed to the equity investors as dividends. So they are the last in line. But if all has gone according to plan, they will still earn a healthy return. All in all, these are quite complicated provisions that are favourable for the project lenders and often rather cumbersome for the project company. If you've worked on projects, you may have found that you face terms dictated by the project lenders and that you considered them to be harsh or unfair or a nuisance. Lenders do have a tendency to get involved in the construction issues and operational issues much more in project finance. But the project company is normally rewarded for bearing with their demands by relatively cheap funding and often at relatively high proportions of debt over the equity. Loans of well over 70% of the total investments are quite common in project finance. We started off this course seeing that banks usually require a larger proportion of risk-bearing equity, and the favourable loan terms in a facilities agreement are only possible because of all the risk mitigation measures that we've applied for the lender. Thanks again for listening, and see you soon.